you for giving me this opportunity to speak here. And thanks for organizing this very nice conference. So I'm a postdoc in Marcus Greiner group at Harvard, and today I'm going to present you some of our most recent results obtained before COVID and published recently concerning single hole dynamics in Fermi Hubbard systems. So in our group, we are interested in the quantum simulation of strongly correlated systems, in particular cuprate compounds, which feature a very rich phase diagram, including an exotic, not so well understood superconducting phase at low temperature and finite hold open. Despite the complexity of this phase diagram, it's believed that most of the physics actually happens coming from interacting electrons on essentially 2D square lattices in these compounds. So these are systems we can simulate in the labs now with cold atoms. Instead of using electrons, we are performing this quantum simulation with ultra-cold atoms, in our case, Fermionic lithium-6, which we load and prepare into two different hyperfine states, two different atomic states, which encode electronic spin. Instead of having a long-range Coulomb interaction, these atoms have like relatively short-range contact interactions coming from van der Waals interactions. And finally, the ionic lattices that is created, in condensed matter compounds is actually here simulated by the interference pattern coming from different laser beams in that form an optical lattice. The kind of Hamiltonian we are modeling now with this simplified system is something you're familiar with. It's the Fermi-Hubbard model, which features a very limited number of energy scales. On the one hand, this Hamiltonian contains a tunneling term, which describes the bare tunneling of single spins between neighboring sites. On the other hand, you can include interactions at the simple level as an on-site interaction between opposite spins, which essentially energetically prevents double occupancy on the same site. This energy scale is given by you in this Hamiltonian. So at high temperatures, the many-body physics of the Fermi-Hubbard are quite simple. They are described by a metallic phase, which is conducting. As soon as you decrease the temperature below this on-site interaction energy, and provided that you are at half fillings, meaning one spin per lattice site, your atoms or your spin starts to end order in terms of density with one single spin per site. Having frozen densities with a finite spin gap doesn't mean, however, that dynamics are totally frozen. Spins can still exchange between neighboring sites by a second order process, the supply exchange or the spin order, the spin exchange, which is given in our case by 40 squared over U, which is the tunneling in U is on-site interaction energy. That extra energy scale now can be frozen by decreasing the temperature even further. And in this case, you have not only density ordering, but also spin ordering, and you expect to have anti-ferromagnetic ordering across the entire square lattice. In our labs, we typically prepare samples where essentially a central half-filling core in a multi-insulating state is surrounded by a densely populated ring, which stores all the entropy that allows us to reach quite low temperatures at the center. And by selectively imaging the spin inside this region, we are able to observe checkerboard patterns, which essentially indicate that we have long-range anti-ferromagnetic correlations that extend over the entire system as temperature is being lowered to energies, to temperatures which are below the supply energy, the supply exchange scale. So on these plots at the bottom, you can really see, as we are decreasing temperature, this anti-ferromagnetic order forming in our system. So these AFM phases have been reached not only in our lab, but also in several other Fermi quantum gas microscopes in different groups. So this AFM phase is obtained at half filling, and that phase in the Fermi-Hubbard phase diagram is pretty well documented. However, as soon as we introduce more holes away from half filling, things become a bit more complicated to compute. And the existence of this superconducting D-wave phase and even the existence of a pseudo gap at finite temperature is something which is debated and not so well understood in the Fermi-Hubbard phase diagram. So our platforms are a very good testbed to compare different theories and to figure out whether these phases are present. You have different ways of probing these phases with cold atoms. Maybe let's say historically, it has been always it easier to look at the thermal equilibrium properties, prepare a system with a given temperature, and take several snapshots of this system to extract thermodynamical quantities. Of course, and that's the topic of this conference. What's even like an extra more interesting step is to look at transport properties, which are essentially probing excitations out of equilibrium, charge excitations, spin excitations, which are very relevant for some of the phases that are included in this Fermi-Hubbard phase diagram. For example, metallic phases or superconductive phases where you can really expect their, let's say, quintessential properties to be described by transport. So transport in cold atoms is a very broad topic. Let me focus on a few examples really relevant to quantum gas microscopes, which were obtained in the last, say, 10 years. I mean, very schematically, you can really maybe consider two extremes of transport. You can, on the one hand, with quantum gas microscopes, maybe probe long wavelength excitations, creating gradients or long wavelength waves, which allow you to probe, let's say, your system maybe more in a linear regime, where your system is well described by phenomenological models, and you're considering macroscopic transport observables like conductance, which you can compare then with theory. Two prominent examples were obtained about 2 years ago in the groups of Wasim Baker at Princeton and Martin Sverlein at MIT. In the first case, looking at charge transport in the bimetallic regime at high temperature and high and finite doping. And on the other hand, in Martin Sverlein group, looking at universal bounds on spin transport in the half field case, which also is something that is very peculiar to cold atom systems and is hard to look in situ with condensed matter systems. So that's one end of the spectrum when you look at long wavelength excitations. You can also leverage the single site accessibility, addressability of quantum gas microscopes to look at more localized excitations where you're considering, well, not only, let's say, one low-lying excited state, but a superposition of excited states far away from equilibrium. And using single site resolution imaging, you can essentially try to track microscopic signatures of quantum coherence. And so there have been also several examples of this over the last few years, looking, for example, at quantum walks in lattices or dynamics of one or several impurities at MPQ in Munich, for example. In our case, so we are interested in the Fermi-Hubbard model, where you have complicated density and spin dynamics. To get an idea, I mean, the most simple transport you can imagine in this case is to add a single hole away from half filling. And already in this case, the outcome of that like simple case depends heavily on dimensionality. In 1D, essentially, upon creating a hole, and shifting this hole away from its origin in a very like very simple nail picture, you expect to create a single domain wall between aligned spins. And once you know this domain wall and this hole are separated and created, they're pretty much free to move ballistically away from each other. The hole can propagate at the tunneling T while this domain wall is moving upon exchange of different spins at the super exchange energy J. So this is a very nice, of course, near picture, but that picture is supported by a more elaborate 1D Tomo-Nagar liquid, where essentially this spin and charge are behaving as separate quasi-particles, which you can dub the spin on and the hole on. And signatures of that spin and charge deconfinement has been obtained already also with quantum gas microscopes in 1D in Emil Bloch's group in Munich. In 2D, things are a bit more complicated, since upon moving, a hole is going to display several spins, creating several domain walls against this nearly antiformatic background. And therefore, you expect to have a more complicated back actions from the spins onto the hole motion. So now in this quasi-particle hole and spin picture, you might wonder whether now this hole and this spin-on are energetically bound to each other and how this composite object is going to move around in your lattice. This problem has been investigated more in the thermodynamic equilibrium, doping Fermi-Hubbard model in a quantum gas microscope with a finite doping. But this problem, which is actually quite emblematic and quite iconic in condensed matter, has never been looked at with a single hole and looking at the full density and spin resolved dynamics. So that's what we have been looking at in our most recent results. Experimentally, I mean, the system is the following. You can see here an average picture of a single hole prepared at the center of a region of about 400 fermions. As a disclaimer here, we are not able to prepare systems at temperatures which are as low as to get long-range AFM correlations. So here, the correlation length is maybe about extending over two sites. So we don't have a full AFM order. We create this hole with a repulsive potential, release it by switching off abruptly this repulsive potential located on one site, and then simply wait for a given time, and after a fixed time, image both density and spin in our lattice and see what's going on. So in terms of density, the results at short times are the following. So here I'm going to show essentially the hole density average over different spatial symmetries of the square lattice and shown in the quadrant. So at t equals zero, holes are localized at the origin at 0, 0. Upon waiting half a tunneling time, the hole delocalizes over adjacent sites. And upon waiting longer, this hole essentially dilutes over a larger area. That behavior in terms of density is quite different from what you would expect from a quantum walk, where the 2D probability distribution is actually expected to be separable and given by the product of square Bessel functions. To be a bit more quantitative, you can look at the hole density both at the origin and on the diagonally adjacent sites and compare that density versus time versus different theories. So it's interesting to look at density on diagonal sites, essentially because diagonal sites, so diagonal neighbors from the origin, or let's say the closest sites to the origin where you can imagine having some interference effects coming from a different path that the hole might take for going from this origin to the neighboring sites. So the experimental data is shown in blue in these time plots. Interference can be simulated by looking at, let's say, theories with different spin backgrounds. If you expect the spin to be the spin background to be fully polarized, essentially these results are described by a single quantum walk, and that quantum walk is indicated in black here, corresponds to the maximal level of interference. This is represented in this plot on the diagonal sides as a maximum oscillation of the density probability after one tunneling time, indicating that you have a maximal interference between two different paths shown on this picture. You can describe the effect of a finite interference in the absence of interactions by going to a random background. This can be simulated using QMC. Depending on the background you prepare for your simulation, sometimes you would have a quantum interference, sometimes not, between paths of this hole. That leads to decrease the oscillation of the amplitude in the diagonal sites. finally, if you go to a fully anti-formatted ordered background using DMRG calculations in ground state, that corresponds to a minimal level of interference. And at this point, you get a minimal oscillation. In our case, we get an oscillation of the density which is located between this random background simulation and this IFM background simulation, which really indicates that we are in an intermediate regime of AFM correlations between no correlations and range of correlations. To be a bit more quantitative about long time delocalization, you can also look at the average root mean square distance of the hole from the origin as a function of time. It follows quite closely a ballistic trend, which is linear in time. So that's what we would expect from a quantum walk. However, at longer times, the distance is lower. You see some ballistic behavior for the exponential data. This can be partially captured by an analytic model based on beta lattice, which essentially considers the propagation of a hole in a spin infinity background. That model predicts a crossover from this ballistic quantum walk behavior to something which is diffusive, with a distance increasing as the square root of time. And so that's a model which only considers minimal interference and no interactions between different spins, no super exchange energy. In our case, it seems like our exponential data is actually being even slower than this simple beta lattice model, which might already hint at the fact that the whole propagation is not only determined by tunneling T, but also the interaction energy and the spin exchange energy between the spins. So to really be able to disentangle tunneling from spin exchange energy and see how these are intermingled in our like the whole dynamics, we can tweak the interactions in our system and using a Fishback resonance and essentially look at the long-term hole distance upon decreasing the super exchange energy by a factor of two. This results in much slower dynamics, here indicated in green. We are unable to very, very accurately probe the spin the density dynamics over long time, so we are unable to extract scaling laws for the RMS distance versus time. However, if we are assuming some kind of ballistic linear motion at long times, we see essentially that the long-term hole velocity is compatible with the renormalization of the quasi-particle bandwidths by J. So really in agreement with our analytical models and numerical results obtained in the last 20 years. In order to gain some insight, we can also alternatively look at the evolution of spin and not density. So what we can look at are correlations, not spin correlations, not from the hole itself. The hole itself is going to delocalize and to be hard to track. So what we are looking at are spin correlations from the center, the origin of the hole and the rest of the system. These spin correlations are again averaged and indicated in this plot over one quadrant of the square lattice. A green color indicates anti-ferromagnetic correlations from the central site indicated in black, while orange correlations indicate AFM order but shifted by a phase of pi, which is at odds with the normal anti-ferromagnetic correlations. Upon waiting and letting the ball propagate for half a tunneling time, we see that actually the correlations are reverting compared to AFM order, which is something that you can easily imagine in a very simple nail picture. If you're looking at the correlations from the origin to the rest of the system, if you wait half a tunneling time, the hole is going to move away from the origin and swap at the origin a spin, which is essentially at odds with the rest of the interferometric order. And therefore you get this reversal, which extends over typically 2 to 3 lattice sites. However, now if you were to wait for a longer time, here up to 20 turning times or 10 super exchange energy times, you see the spin background relaxing to a normal AFM state. So now quantitatively, if you look at spin correlations on a diagonal bond as a function of time, you can see a reversal at of the correlations over timescales which are compatible with the tunneling energy, while a further relaxation towards equilibrium takes much, much longer times, which are comparable to the super exchange energy. So you have now in the spin dynamics, the interplay and the separation between two timescales again, the tunneling energy and the super exchange energy. We can try to describe this, spin correlation data using very simple models, where we are essentially trying to, maybe if I were to provide a rough outline of these simulations, essentially describe the motion of the relative motion between a hole-on and a spin-on using the beta lattice theory I described to you. In our simulations, hole-on and spin-on are bound by a linear potential that you can compute to implement, you know, the back action of the spin on the string. The two objects are bound, but you can also consider a global center of mass motion using the tidal-Wangi dispersion relation of magnetic polaron that has been obtained in previous papers too, which is dominated by the super exchange energy J. And essentially what we are doing is to, using this kind of composite model, try to generate experimental correlations from experimental spin snapshots we've measured at zero time, and essentially performing some swapping and shifting of our spin backgrounds and spin correlations in order to generate spin correlation at finite time. So the results are the following. If you are considering this composite model without considering a global center of mass motion dictated by J, by the polaron, essentially correlations can, the correlations close to the origin can be well described at finite time. But however, it doesn't describe the relaxation of the central correlations and the rearrangement of the spins towards equilibrium. We only get a full description of our results by including J and the super exchange energy and the global center of mass motion of the polaron, which is this shaded blue line here. So our model is not, it's not a full smoking gun of polaronic behavior in our system, given also the fact that we have a finite probing of finite time sampling and quite large error bars. But at least we see in the spin dynamics that both tunneling and spin exchange energies play a role, and we see that these polaron models can fit with our data. We can furthermore not only look at correlations from the origin, but also correlations between neighboring sites all around, like over the entire system. So nearest neighbor correlations in the limit of large repulsive interactions are essentially giving you the magnetic energy which is stored in bonds in the Heisenberg model. So essentially, at larger interaction strengths, you could interpret the plot I'm going to show you as the local magnetic energy stored at a given distance from the origin. So at short times here, t equals zero and one turning time, you see that the motion of the hole is going to disrupt the local magnetic correlations and essentially impart some energy to the spin background. And therefore, that can be seen as a decrease of the correlations locally. And as you wait for time to go by, you see how now this magnetic energy is being, and these correlations are being delocalized over the entire system. So again, along the x-axis, you see correlations as a function of distance from the origin. And again, these correlations are well captured, at least at long times, by our polaronic model. So, All right, that's pretty much it for this talk. I would like to thank my team and also very fruitful discussions we had with our theory collaborators, Annabelle Bort, Fabian Brust, and Eugene Dammer. And if you want more information, you can check our latest results. Yes, I'm looking forward to your questions.
Thank you very much, Martin, for a very interesting talk. So we have time for questions. I think Leonid, please.
Yeah, maybe just to break the silence. it's a fascinating talk and subject. So you looked, as far as I said, on a square lattice. Did you try a triangular lattice where you expect frustrations, and I guess the dynamics may be different for the whole.
No, we don't. We don't have access. We cannot implement a triangular lattice in our system yet. But it's a project, and that's something we are like seriously thinking about. That would require some upgrade expansion. Yes, that's definitely a very interesting question.
What does that mean? Is there a difficulty with just arranging the laser beams to have another lens, or what is
Yeah,
it?
so maybe I can show you what we plan to do. So our lattice beams are arranged,
Okay.
perpendicular to each other. So the way to implement this triangle lattice is along the lines of what has
Okay.
been done in Zurich. And so that would require adding an extra lattice beam, which is non-interfering. And
Okay.
we would get this kind of triangle lattice here.
Thank you.
And maybe can I ask like sort of related question? So if instead of changing the lattice, can you just change initial patterns, maybe charge patterns, so that you introduce, I don't know, some stripes or whatever? I mean, I just wonder how much flexibility you have in doing different updates.
That's definitely possible. So these initial states are produced by using a repulsive potential, which we can shape very like almost arbitrarily. So stripes have actually been produced in previous papers from our group, not from the perspective of dynamics, but more to try to prepare states of the Fermi-Hobson model with lower entropies. So that's definitely possible. We would be also able to not only prepare deterministically stripes or single holes, but also kind of modulate in time that potential. That's also something that might be interesting. I mean, concerning the prospect of like a very natural generalization of this project is also to prepare several holes and look, for example, whether holes could bind to each other. And so maybe, going away from the half-ling case simply by injecting holes one by one and somehow building from the bottom up this doped phase. So that's definitely something we could do as well.
Is anything of this like you're currently planning, or this is just sort of so far on the level of ideas? Or
It's more ideas. Probably to have a better control. So, due to, I mean, it's very technical, but due to optical aberrations, it's kind of challenging to very reliably produce one hole with like unity fidelity without introducing a bit of disorder on the neighboring sites. So, probably a bit of experimental work would be helpful to get a cleaner and system and initial states with higher fidelities. That's say more the idea of project right now, but principle, that's something we could do.
Okay. Are there any more questions? So, I don't see any right now. So, okay, then let's thank Martin again, and I think we will finish the morning session and we will reconvene in 1 hour. Thank you, everyone, especially thank all the speakers.